We're back with David Henry Hwang, and I want to talk now a little bit about your early beginnings. You were born in L.A., mm-hmm. and you were raised in L.A. When did you first come to know the theater?
You know, I'm not someone who went to theater as a kid. I didn't think I was going to become a writer. I was a violinist. My mom's a pianist. My sister ended up becoming a professional cellist. And, you know, I was a Chinese kid, so I played violin. So
what's that supposed to mean?
You know, it's part of the stereotype that Asian kids learn instruments. But in my case, that happened to be true. So I played in pit orchestras in high schools, and I saw some musicals that way. But really not until I got to college. I was in my freshman year, the dorm would go to see plays.
At Stanford.
I went to Stanford.
Yes, and you were studying?
I didn't know what I was studying. Okay. I mean, I just went to college.
Good answer.
I didn't know. And I hadn't chosen a major. We would go up and see plays at, I remember going up to American Conservatory mm-hmm. Theater in San Francisco.
Sure.
And I saw, like, The Tempest, and I saw Thornton Wilder's play, The Matchmaker, and I started to think, oh, maybe I can do that. So I started writing plays in my spare time in college, and I found a professor who was willing to take a look at them, and he told me they're really bad, which they were, and my problem was that I wanted to write plays, but I didn't actually know anything about the theater. But the same professor was a good guy, and we sort of designed a playwriting major together where I would basically end up seeing as many plays and reading as many plays as I could over the next few years. And
how
that
incredible.
Basically became my education. And then my senior year, I wrote a play to be performed in my dorm.
Right,
which was FOB.
Or FOB.
Yep, FOB or FOB. And through a variety of fortuitous circumstances, it ended up being produced here off-Broadway about 14 months later.
At the Public Theater.
Yep.
And explain how it got in the hands of Joe Papp.
Joe Papp. Yeah, Joe Papp,
for some of your viewers
who don't know, Joe was arguably the most influential American theater producer of the last half of the 20th century. And he created Shakespeare in the Park,
right.
He founded the Public Theater, he produced lots of, most of the important American playwrights of that day went through the Public Theater, and also Joe produced a lot of them on Broadway, and also produced A Chorus Line, which was a huge, huge success.
Say the least.
Yeah. So, let's see. Honestly, what happened was that about the time that I was doing my play in my dorm, the Public produced a play called New Jerusalem, in which there was an Asian character who was portrayed by a Caucasian actor. And this led to protests by Asian actors of that day who felt, oh, well, this should be an opportunity for us. And it's an example of quote-unquote yellowface casting, mm-hmm. where blackface casting, like where a white actor puts on makeup to play African-American. We generally don't do that anymore. And this was an example of yellowface casting. And Joe, being the kind of guy he was, he ended up inviting the protesters into his office and hiring one of them onto his staff with a mandate to look for plays for Asian actors. And it was just about that time that my play came across their desks. So I always...
Did you submit it to them?
I did.
Okay.
I sent it to them, and also I sent it to something called the O'Neill National Playwrights Conference
right.
in Waterford, Connecticut.
Yes.
And it got selected to be done there. And my director at the O'Neill, where they do kind of staged readings of new plays with professional actors and directors, my director there was a resident director for Joe Papp at the time. So it sort of came to the Public two ways. So I consider myself sort of the beneficiary of affirmative action, because there was a slot that was created. I was the guy who got, who got to take advantage of that. And then Joe did what's called a reading of the play, which means you get some actors, they basically sit in chairs like we're doing now, they read the play just from the text, and then just to get a sense, just to hear it. And then afterwards, Joe took me into his office, and I was 21 or 22 or something, and he was Joe Papp, and I was just like, well, yeah, obviously I wanted him to like me. And Joe said, I like this play, but I have a few notes. And he gave me some suggestions, and I didn't actually agree with them, but he was Joe Papp, and so Joe said, okay, now go home and, do a new draft and send it back to me, and I'll decide whether I want to produce the play. So I went back home, and I waited 3 weeks, and I sent him back the exact same script. And about 10 days later, the phone rings, and it's Joe Papp, and he's like, okay, the play's great, now we're going to produce it.
So he just saw it with different eyes. It sat with him for a little while, and it settled.
You know, I think also it's that when people give notes on a play, they don't necessarily remember their own notes. Mm. And it was to some extent just to establish a power relationship between mm-hmm. Joe and I, and I didn't say no. I just didn't do them. And I guess that was fine. I don't quite know how that all worked.
And this was not long after you really had started playwriting.
Yeah.
So what was it for you that clicked from having a professor go, no, your writing is horrible, to having your show being produced by Joe Papp in New York in what?
Yeah,
in 3 or 4 years?
Yeah, 2 or 3 years. You know, I think the biggest learning experience for me was the summer before my senior year in college. I got to study playwriting with Sam Shepard, the sort of great American Pulitzer Prize winning playwright who some of your viewers may also know as a movie star.
Yes.
And Maria Irene Fornes, who was a wonderful off-Broadway playwright. And they taught us to kind of write more from our unconscious. That is to, like, your conscious mind is of course useful in many ways, but it's also the part that sometimes goes, oh, this isn't good enough, why do you think you can do this, who's going to be interested in this stuff, and just to try to bypass that more and go with your gut, go with your impulses.
Less filtered.
Yeah, and you know, I didn't know I was going to write about East-West subjects, I just wanted to be a playwright, but when I started doing that, I found some of these themes started appearing on the page, things that I didn't know I was interested in, like, you know, immigration and assimilation. And so clearly some part of me was incredibly interested in these issues, mm-hmm. but my conscious
all things
mind
that you've continued to,
yeah,
to explore.
I mean, it set my path.
Sure.
But my conscious mind hadn't figured that out yet.
Were your parents supportive of your pursuits as a young person?
You know, they were, I sometimes make this joke about Chinese parents, which is a broad cultural generalization, but you know, that Asian parents, like if they, as long as you're getting good grades, you can do whatever you want in your spare time. So I was getting good grades, so they were fine if I wanted to write plays in my spare time. But when I really got serious about it, and I wrote this play FOB, and I said I was going to, you know, do it in my dorm, my dad wanted to take a look at it, and he was an immigrant, he'd never read a play before, and he saw some swear words, and he was like, oh, I send you to this fancy college, and you write this junk. But he also said to my mom, well, we're going to go up and see it. And if it's good, we'll encourage him. And if it's bad, we'll tell him to stop.
Wow.
So they came up to see this thing in the dorm. At the end, my dad was like in tears. And he was like really moved. And, you know, there were a lot of the kind of immigration stories that I borrowed from some of his stories. And so after that, he was quite supportive. And then, as I said, you know, things happened for me really quickly. I was very lucky in that respect. But, you know, then he became very proud. And he'd carry my clippings around and, you know.
We'll be right back with David Henry Hwang.